Hello, this is Dr. Ezra Sidran, and I am very excited to show off the General Staff Wargaming System today. There are three different eras for the General Staff Wargaming System. This is the black powder version, which covers the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries. We also anticipate coming out with a General Staff Modern Warfare and a General Staff Ancient Warfare. Parts of this program are completely done. Others are in beta, others are in alpha. I'm going to just show what we've got. I'm really excited because this is the first unveiling that we've been able to do. Now, I happen to personally be very fond of this 19th century Victorian style. I just absolutely love it. And I know from doing surveys with our users that this isn't always the case. Some people prefer a modern style. And going with the overarching theme of our work is to allow complete customization by the user. So you don't like 19th century typography? Great. You just click here and boom. We've got this modern warfare style. It looks very similar to UMS. However, I'm doing a demo. I prefer Victorian, so I'm going to go back to this. Built into this are all the things you need to create your own scenarios. Let's start with the army editor. The army editor allows you to create your own armies. This is the army editor. I'm going to start off by expanding it full screen, and I'm just going to load some of our pre-designed armies. Let's see, this one is obviously the Army of Northern Virginia, September 17th, 1862. That would be for the Battle of Antietam. The whole idea behind this is to make it so easy to just click and drag and create your order of battle tables. You can select these various unit types, skirmishing options, actual strengths. This is the strength for a simple version, a simple war game. I'll explain that later. Shooting effect, first shot bonus, the range, and of course the accuracy. You can select from pre-designed accuracy curves, or you can actually draw your own. This supports a digital pen, or you can just click with with your mouse, whatever style you want. Amount of ammunition, time it takes to reload, close combat values, leadership values, quality, morale, and it's really simple to just cut and paste and create these order of battle tables. Next, back here, we're going to need to create maps, right? So the thing about the map editor is that we've built in all these easy to use design tools that supports a digitizing pen, but you can use a mouse as well. I've found from having created a number of maps, the biggest problem you're going to run into is simply getting a good quality map to start off with. The Library of Congress is a good source. But you need high resolution maps. So let's take a look at Little Bighorn. This map we actually got from the National Park. The Little Bighorn Battlefield National Park Service provided this map and the order of battle tables as well, which was really helpful. So this is one of the underlying layers. Maps are made up of layers. I'm going to load the background image. The background image just is really for us users, and I'll show you what the AI sees and what the user sees and how they're completely different. So this is the actual map. We have many layers here. We can turn these layers on and off. We've got an elevation map. This is the elevation map underneath it. You can see this. We have a terrain map. We can also turn on and off the grid. That's just to help us calculate distances. We can turn on and off these places. Built into this map editor is everything you need. You just click on these tools and you just draw away. Again, you can use a mouse or a digitizing pen. It's all object-oriented, so you can click on objects and move them, create them, delete them, whatever you need. We have built-in snap lines, which are straight lines, very helpful for roads. Obviously not so important at the Battle of Little Bighorn. You can import elevation data directly from Google if you want. You can import grayscale elevation maps. You can check out your terrain sets. A lot of really nice built-in features for this. Now that you've created a couple of armies and you've created a map, next step is to create your own scenarios. Now, a scenario is composed of two armies, and they can be any two armies in a map, and any map. There's no reason that you have to be historic. You can be, but you don't have to be. Let's take a look at, the Battle of Antietam, let's say. So we've got the Battle of Antietam map, which actually came in from the West Point Atlas. And we've got two orders of battles for the Army of Northern Virginia and the Army of the Potomac. We're going to turn off some of these layers that we don't need. And you can position these units. You get complete order of battle tables. They're just imported right in. This is what they look like. You can click and drag. It's information about all these units. You can make units come in on certain turns. You can put them in line or column formation. Right-clicking will tell you everything you need to know. Hovering over will tell you the units, their strengths, their leadership, ammunition. Also calculates how long it will take for orders to be transmitted by courier from one unit to the next, from the headquarters unit down. And there's the path the courier will actually take. Next we can, General Staff AI Editor. So the AI Editor allows you to set objectives for specific units. And here's an example. So we'll load, let's load the Antietam scenario real fast. And one of the ways that the AI perceives the battlefield, and we're going to take a look exactly how the AI sees the battlefield. It looks at what we call battle groups, and you can see that it's separated the red and blue forces into battle groups and supporting battle groups. The next thing we need to do is to show what's called calculate the range of influence. Normally we wouldn't show this, but after the AI has calculated the range of influence, you'll see exactly how the AI sees the battlefield, which is completely different than how we see the battlefield. So this is what the battlefield looks like to the AI. The blue and red areas are, and the intensity of the colors show what areas are controlled by what sides. So we can click on a battle group, and we can now give it objectives. So this is the 1st and 12th Corps of the Union Army at Antietam. And we're going to give this the first objective, and then we're going to make this the second objective. And then we're going to ask it to calculate the best strategy, the best tactics to perform this maneuver. And here is the step-by-step process of what the AI is going to do. This goes back to my work that was originally done for DARPA. This blue square right here is the area that this army is going to attack. This battle group is going to slice right through here, right around this left flank. Let's take a look at the tactics for this. Is Burnside's corps, and of course it's famous, as you know, for Burnside's bridge at the Battle of Antietam. So here we've got a different situation, and you can see that we have a series of instructions that the blue battle group is has a severely restricted avenue of attack because of this bridge. Burnside's bridge is a choke point. That's Burnside's bridge, and it's controlled by opposition forces, which is the Confederates. So then it spits out what we call a course of action, and the course of action is to advance this artillery unit, 1st Division Artillery, to within 735 meters with a clear 3D line of sight to point. This is the point that's the Confederate defensive position, and you can see it's generating the course of action to move up the artillery to cover the bridge and then eventually order an infantry attack. So let's take a look now at some of the scenarios that we've already created. This is First Bull Run. This is the American Kriegsspiel scenario. This is a pursuit scenario that was actually first published in 1888. This is the actual map, actual scenario, actual order of battle, everything that was created in 1888 by Captain Livermore. This, of course, is Antietam. We just saw that. Now, here's an example of some of the things that we can do with the General Staff Wargaming system that I'm really excited about. So, here's Little Bighorn. Let's start off with, here's Little Bighorn just as it was historically. We have the Native American positions right here, and we have Custer's 7th Cavalry just in the historical positions. But look, we also know that Custer turned down four companies. He was offered four extra companies from the 2nd U.S. Cavalry. He was turned down, the famous line, of course, the 7th can handle whatever it encounters. Let's do a scenario with that. Let's use this, and let's add those four companies from the 2nd U.S. Cavalry. Or how about this? What if Custer had taken those four companies from the 2nd U.S. Cavalry and those famous Gatling guns that he turned down? So that's this scenario. Quatre Bras. And again, if you don't like the 19th century look, you're more than free to switch over to this high-tech look, which actually is a design style that I used for an Office of Naval Research project I did for the U.S. Marines. They seem to be very happy with it. Okay, so that's a very, very quick look at the General Staff Black Powder Wargaming System. Hopefully, I've put my email address down below and you'll be able to take a look and send me more questions or check out our website. Thank you.